Today, guys, we are going to be jumping off of...
Yes. Hello, everyone. How you doing? Welcome to another episode of Jumping Off Points, the podcast where we use topical events in the news as jumping off points to explore wider issues around politics and culture. My name is Timbah. I'm here with my boy.
Yes, it's Aidan. How you doing, mate?
Yeah, I'm very good, man. What about you?
I'm good. I feel like I'm really getting into the festive spirit this year. When I was younger, I didn't really care about all the kind of build up to Christmas. I was just like, you know, when Christmas happens, great. Now I realize as you get older, those little moments of Christmas before you get to Christmas, that's really the whole Christmas.
I do know what you mean. To be honest, I'm a Christmas simp. Every year I get super into it. When people talk to me about it and they say the magic is gone, I don't get it.
The magic is only burning brighter every year.
Speaking of, we have a very special episode today, don't we, Aidan?
Hugely special. And probably one of those episodes where someone's going to comment saying, this isn't politics.
And as usual, they would have no legitimate grounds and we would fight them in the comments aggressively. So I was talking to my buddy Aidan about what's been going on in the news recently. And I asked him, what do you think is the biggest political event we could actually center our podcast around? And he was like, what about 2003 rom-com directed by Richard Curtis, Love Actually? And I said, that seems unrelated, but I want to do it. So let's do it.
I think what you've just done there is so dishonest, because every year at Christmas, Tim has said to me, you know, there's something about the Prime Minister scene in Love Actually that just really sticks with me. And I really need to talk about it. Finally, you've given yourself that platform to do
so.
No,
man, Aidan, it's your chick flick. It's on you. But now that we're there, now that it's been suggested, it's been put out there into the ether, I will grab onto it and talk about it for the purposes of podding, you know?
So what is it about Love Actually that you think warrants a podcast episode, Tim?
The reason why you thought it warranted a podcast episode, Aidan, is every year I see a lot of Christmas films. I am bombarded with them. And I bombard myself with them on purpose. I kind of enjoy the kitschy pacing of Christmas films. I like the attempts to simulate some real character action around Christmas, some dilemmas. The usual plot of every Christmas film is something like this. There's a busybody businessman or a busybody businesswoman, and they've got a child who's into Christmas, or they've got a partner who's more into Christmas than them. They're too busy for it. You know, I've got so much going on. Christmas is stupid. I'm all about my business affairs. They go back to a small hometown. They realize what Christmas is all about. And they realize that Santa's real, that it means something that you can grab onto that's palpable, and that it's a really important day that we should all celebrate to the fullest. But then I watch Love Actually, and I go in with the expectations that I will be seeing something adjacent or on a level with those other films I'm watching. And then I start watching it and I find that it's a very, very different experience. I find that the way it's executed, the pacing, the characterization of the people in it, the locations, the way the story moves from plot beat to plot beat is surprisingly good.
You just did the worst job of pretending that you weren't interested in talking about this film. I also love watching Christmas films, and I also think that this one, it's quite different to a lot of Christmas films, but also I think because it's very British, it really strikes a chord with people in the UK, right? And it's so, I think it's probably the most popular Christmas watch in the UK.
I would be writing an angry letter to the TV ratings agency or the film rating agency if that wasn't the case. I don't know what could possibly be like picking up more ratings than this. Where I would start, I guess, is a little bit of a synopsis of where Love Actually emerged from. When I was growing up and I was in a house with my older sister, she was really into it. But for me, just like Moulin Rouge, just like The Notebook, this is one of the films that got dragged out of nowhere and just was on all the time because of having an older sister. Turns out the director of Love Actually there was a pathway to Love Actually being released that went like this. Richard Curtis put out the film Four Weddings and a Funeral in the 90s. That was a runaway success, not actually intentionally or not expectedly to be as big as it was, but became one of the defining British films of that era and sort of changed the way that people saw rom-coms in general. It was a rom-com, but without the sentimentality of American rom-coms and the over-exaggeration of like the emotive moments, basically. That's what Richard Curtis does quite well, I think.
Fiona loves you.
Fiona calls me Duckface.
Well, I never heard that.
Almost in the same way that we look at the UK Office, the way that revolutionized TV comedies by not having a laughter track and it being about the awkward sensibilities of the characters from scene to scene. After Four Weddings and a Funeral, he then releases Bean, the Mr. Bean film. He then releases Notting Hill, which goes on to be the highest grossing British film of all time at that moment. He then releases Bridget Jones's Diary. All of these films becoming cult classics in their own right, where we specifically are dropping moments of that film. So like Notting Hill, I'm Just a Girl Looking at a Boy, Wondering if He Will Accept Me. All of these like dialogue that has come spilling out of his films. There's so much of it. It would be impossible to catalog it all at once. You just recognize these lines when they come up. So all iconic in their own right. And this dude suddenly declares he's releasing a fucking Christmas film. It's like, what? Are you serious? Are you serious?
Yeah. For me, one of the most defining parts about the film is the portrayal of the Prime Minister. It's quite common in action films and stuff to have portrayals of the political leaders in the United States. But to have a really popular film where you've got a character who's the British Prime Minister, I think is more rare.
Portrayed in a really humanizing way. The sort of performances we see in those action films when it's the president, the plot might centrally concern the president in some way. But he's either playing like the surrogate sergeant at the police station. Look, I know you get the job done, but you damn it, you make a big mess. I've got to send my men in there to clean up that mess that you made. You got the job done, but...
at what cost?
Yeah, yeah. Or he's like a guy who's like, president, like, can we launch the missiles? He's like, I don't know. It's very, very shallow character portrayals. In this film, we have a prime minister who is... very in the spirit of all of Hugh Grant's roles throughout Richard Curtis's films. He has a profound discomfort in his own skin. He feels at odds with his surroundings in a way which is palpable in every scene. He is a nerd who doesn't really know how to connect to women and yet seems to outwardly, when he's with other people, possess all this charm and charisma that is effortless when he's performing in front of the public, for example. But then you see him in a situation with a girl and it all goes to shit. That is a remarkably humanizing representation of a politician. And actually, it's mad thinking back that he got away with that, that we let that fly as the British public, because we don't take kindly to the politicians.
Yeah, and I also think the film Love Actually is set in a very different political time. Obviously, it came out in 2003, which is when Tony Blair was Prime Minister. And it's a time before we had the same kind of access to politicians.
Well, recently, over the last few years, we've had Matt Hancock feeling up his aide in the corridor, which was on that CCTV. We've had Boris Johnson and his multiple wives, multiple children. We've had the... what do we call it? Pestgate?
Pestminster,
where conservatives are watching porn in the Houses of Parliament.
An MP has been accused by a female colleague of watching porn on his phone in the Commons chamber.
Event after event that's shown us that this dignified aura that we frequently drape around the political class isn't as we thought it was. And so at this point, the plot of Love Actually, where a prime minister... it's kind of coming on to an aide. And it seems very, very charming and very off the wall, very oddball behavior for a politician. Just now, it doesn't really hit the same. It's like, oh, it's very seedy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think it's also one of those things where if it wasn't Hugh Grant, who's like devilishly handsome and clearly very charming, it would be really creepy and weird, right?
So, right, I want to go into dissecting that and lots of the other character arcs. But first... I just want to put aside these other things that I think just fit better here because they'll come across as weirdly, sweepingly broad if I bring them in later. So what do you think to the thesis that Love Actually is not actually a rom-com about Britain, It's a rom-com about London.
Well, here's my thoughts about the setting. It's a version of London, like the whole film is in a version of London that to me, as someone who lives in London, doesn't exist. All of the people in it own ridiculously nice houses in the middle of London. So the setting, their London setting is like the beautiful high-rise buildings and like, you know, the Thames in the middle and everything, which is not the reality for most people who live in London.
It's really interesting you should say that because this is one of the things I specifically thought going through it. Because of the narrative need to tie the plot lines together, they have the Prime Minister's sister, Karen, who lives in Wandsworth and is portrayed as she's the Prime Minister's sister. She's very upper middle class from that privileged background. And you also have Natalie, who is the Prime Minister's aide, who is from the quote-unquote dodgy end of Wandsworth. And yet they seem to live like within two roads of each other. Like they both send their kids to the same primary school, which is just around the corner from where Natalie lives. And so it's like, what? So is the Prime Minister's sister sending her kids to like a really dodgy primary school? Or like, what's going on here?
Where do you live, for instance?
Wandsworth, the dodgy end.
Ah, my sister lives in Wandsworth.
At the end of the film, there's obviously this sequence where the Prime Minister is knocking door to door to try and find Natalie. And the house where he finds Natalie, which is her parents' house, which is supposedly in Wandsworth, but it's not filmed there, is estimated to be worth now over £1 million. and obviously, they are in the film. That family is the most convincingly working class element, and they're so far off it.
So, I mean, he's going from door to door, and he's like, oh, I've got to go to the dodgy end of Wandsworth. And then he's knocking door on door on house after house that I cannot afford.
Also, just to look at who the kind of main characters are and what kind of social class they're from. You know, you've got the Prime Minister, you've got the guy who is a professional author who has a house in France where he can go. You've got the guy who owns an art gallery. Some of them are not much older than us. Do you know what I mean? And they've got these like ridiculous houses, ridiculous careers.
What do you think of the representations of the working class in this film?
For me, there are two main characters who are supposed to be working class in the film. There's Colin, the muffin guy, who sells... Well, he doesn't even sell muffins. He gives out muffins in an office to hot women.
I was like, I'm trying to make my living as a muffin delivery guy here. It's fucking insane with these taxes. I'm trying to deliver muffins here.
It's like, who is paying him to do that work? So he does that part-time, and he also walks around at a fancy event handing out appetizers.
It might be they're not going for working class with him. It's more that he is one of the few representations of someone who isn't obviously portrayed as being one of the posh elite.
Yeah.
And yet the way he speaks is like, oh, hello, would you like a hors d'oeuvre? Blah, blah, blah.
Somehow, as a muffin delivery man, he manages to pay for a trip to America over Christmas. And he goes from London to Wisconsin. And I looked up what that flight price is. And for a return, it's about £800 at least.
In the holiday season as well.
It's yeah, like yeah.
Last minute, close to Christmas. He comes back at New Year. let's not sweep that under the rug, the specific time that he's doing this.
Yeah.
And then we have the other representation of the working class, which is Natalie, who works directly for the Prime Minister. And the representation of class that we see through Natalie seems to be based on the premise that they can't really control their swears very well.
When they have their meet cute, the way that the film tells you Natalie is working class is that he introduces herself to her and she just starts randomly swearing, like saying, oh, fuck, oh, piss.
Shit, I can't believe I've just said that. And now I've gone and said shit twice. I'm so sorry, sir.
It's fine. You could have said fuck and then we'd have been in real trouble.
Thank you, sir. I did have an awful premonition I was going to fuck up on my first day. Oh, piss it.
Oh, God. I keep doing it.
And then, like, I love that while she's doing that, the Prime Minister is looking at her like, oh, that is so charmingly refreshing.
He finds it all just witty and like endearing. Amusing.
He's like, I've never seen someone so hot swear. It's such a beautiful thing to see.
That is just fantastic.
Yeah, so basically, my thoughts on the portrayal of class in the whole film is that it's kind of the portrayal of working class that you might expect from someone who moved all over the world as a child because their dad was a global executive and then went to a really fancy British school. The detail of the differences in class in reality are felt not to be important in the terms of how you tell a story in the film. And I think that's fine. I don't care.
It doesn't at all damage the story in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
It's just funny.
It's just funny, yeah.
Like Richard Curtis might have in his head, he's like, well, there's high class and there's low class and there's the middle bit. I'm in the middle. Therefore, muffin delivery guy, low social status, below me. Prime Minister, obviously way more posh, way more elite than me. And then all the characters, like the middling ones, turn out to be these like CEO of a marketing agency, yeah, director of an art gallery, you know, these guy who owns a like French retreat house for his writing, you know. And that I guess that's probably the role that fits most with Richard Curtis, right? He's a writer. He might go away to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not a accurate depiction, but that doesn't take away from it being a very, very amusing and interesting depiction of like British tropes, British characters, British life.
Yeah, definitely.
So I think it's worth going into, you know, some of the specific subplots now. And Aidan, bless him, did a heroic job trying to make them relatable to the politics theme of our usual episodes. Aidan, do you want to tell everyone what you came out with? Do you want to go in the order they are on here?
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Do you want to tell everyone what you came out with for the for Prime Minister subplot?
Okay, so I think it's worth bearing in mind that this is not a political film, but in order to do this podcast, I had to do some political analysis of the different storylines in the film. So the first and most obviously political is the Prime Minister and Natalie. Newly elected Prime Minister falls in love with his new member of staff. It seems to me like the dispute that the Prime Minister has with the US President who comes to visit represents the tension felt in the UK after the fallout of the Iraq War.
So this is one of the more straightforward ones. I can already see you going through this podcast. Every time I get you to state the representation you've come out with, it's like a year nine doing his assignment in front of the class. Like, Aidan, what theme does this represent? And he's like, I think it means feminism. let me qualify this by saying that I haven't gone all the way into it. But yeah, no, this was actually a very, I think I'd say, out of all the political themes, the most overt one. Richard Curtis himself has said this was like a driving thrust of the Prime Minister's subplot.
In the film, the Prime Minister is unhappy with the US President because he has tried to get off with Natalie, who he fancies. And he turns that into a political speech about how the UK is prepared to stand up to the US and not do everything at once.
I fear that this has become a bad relationship. A relationship based on the president taking exactly what he wants and casually ignoring all those things that really matter to Britain.
I think the whole plotline speaks to something that the British people would like. The British people would like to feel like we're really important on the world stage. And so it's really nice to watch someone shout down the evil American president.
I think the film is like our therapy animal after the invasion of Iraq. We want to feel like there's an alternate universe where we didn't go down that course of action. In America, you can quantify the Iraq invasion very differently. It had 74% support. A plurality of liberals supported it, although by a very, very slim margin. It was something like between 50 and 60% from my recollection. But a massive majority of Republicans supported it. It was 90% of Republicans. So it's not like the US president went against what the public wanted at that time. You can say that he misled them and so on and so forth. But I think we all know that underpinning the invasion of Iraq was a feeling that by going and intimidating a country in the Middle East where they were having problems, they might be able to curb the terrorist attacks that would come in the future, because that's the way America thought it could deal with it.
So I think in the UK, there was still a lot of support for the war.
There was 54% support for the war.
54. So still a majority of support.
But that's like the level of support that Brexit had when it got pushed through. It's the slimmest of slim margins. It's not at all the support you would want as the Prime Minister who's committed to that course of action.
Yeah, and I think also it's really significant that in the US, it was someone on the right. It was George Bush, right? Whereas in the UK, it was Tony Blair, who was supposed to be the representative of the left, who were the group less in favour of the war.
As a very illustrative flavour of attitudes towards Tony Blair at the time of the Iraq war, he took part in a question time where members of the public were allowed to just aggressively question the Prime Minister. And I just want to play you a few clips from this question time because I think it's really, really revealing.
Prime Minister, you must see the evidence that was presented yesterday as laughable. It was Morecambe and Wise-esque.
How can we possibly justify criticising Iraq developing nuclear weapons when we're doing so little to get rid of our own? Isn't it incredibly hypocritical?
And I'm very concerned that we're following the US along a line of conflict and war, and I don't understand why.
The United States has sort of been aggressive towards Afghanistan and now Iraq. Where's it going to stop? Who's going to be next?
I don't share any confidence that the people are behind you at the moment. Everybody that I've spoken to within my circle oppose what's happening at the moment.
Big, big, big resentment it caused over Europe. I mean, Germany publicly said that it was an illegal invasion. France publicly disagreed with the decision. We got to Eurovision that year and it was an absolute, you know, nil point from every single country. And I can't help but think that our invasion of Iraq really did screw up chances of that poor duet that we sent out to sing their little song.
That's the real travesty in all of this.
Do you want to listen to that song? Let's realize you.
What year was it from?
Eurovision. It would be Eurovision 2003, right? 2003. Eurovision 2003. It was in May. It was like 2 months after the or 3 months after the invasion.
Oh, is it Gemini Crybaby?
Oh my God, yeah. So wonderful singing, very on key, a great performance that unfortunately was thwarted by the illegal invasion of a country far, far away.
The top comment on this YouTube video where I'm watching the song is, they scored 1 point for every note they sung in tune.
Oh, that's harsh. Oh, that's harsh. Who did Germany put that? Look at the identity. Are they from Germany? Germany, grow up, all right? Don't take it out on our little Eurovision duet, all right? But yeah, no, back to the point. What I'm intrigued to know. What did you make of that little speech by the Prime Minister?
That speech where he's talking about Britain might be small, but we're the home of the Beatles, the blah, 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 you know, we're great.
We may be a small country, but we're a great one too. The country of Shakespeare, Churchill, the Beatles, Sean Connery, Harry Potter.
That, I think, in a nutshell, is what a lot of people love about Love Actually. We've got this format, which is like American rom-coms, but we're doing it our way, in a way yes. that we like.
Yeah. We're wrinkly, alcoholic buggers, and we swear at the bus when it leaves.
Have you heard the David Cameron Love Actually moment?
No, what's that?
Okay, so in 2013, David Cameron made a speech in reply to a comment from Russia that... So Russia basically said that no one cares what Britain thinks. They're a very small country about some geopolitical issue. And David Cameron then gave a speech very similar to the one in Love Actually.
Yes, we are a small island. In fact, a small group of islands. But I would challenge anyone to come up with a country with a prouder history, with a bigger heart, with a greater resilience. Our music delights and amuses millions. The Beatles, Elgar, and slightly less congressly One Direction have conquered the world. We've invented most of the sports that the world most likes playing.
I love that from Putin as well. Nobody cares about England. No one is trying to hack their systems and look at what they're doing. So yeah, sure you don't care, mate.
Yeah, sure.
So I found this really amusing. The gambit of the Prime Minister subplot is that we have to disagree with America on something. and yet we're not allowed to explicitly name any particular policy in specific. So all the way through the film, including the speech, we're just sort of like treading around the edges of what the actual disagreement is.
No, absolutely not. We cannot and will not consult on that either.
That is unexpected.
It's like, what? Consult on what?
The last administration made it perfectly clear. We're just being consistent with their policies.
Well, with all respect, sir, they were bad policies.
And it's like, what were the policies? What are we talking about? And it's like, all the way through, we've got this like interplay of like, the thing that you're saying is not the thing that we want to do. And then US saying, well, guess what? That thing is the thing that you've got to do, and you've got to do it now.
I think the whole, even though it's like a really political setting, they've made it very apolitical, haven't they? They've made it so it's uncontroversial and you can enjoy watching it as someone who thinks anything about politics.
Yes, very much so. They don't really hint towards whether, for example, the Prime Minister David is a Labour or Conservative guy. So I would say, and this is a running theme, that the character of David, Prime Minister, and his actions are very much softened by, one, the other characters he's interacting with, big one being the president. They have a conversation where David makes a comment, well, you know, dating and politics, obviously they don't go that well together, do they? I've got no time for dating. And the president is like, I have found that I can get lots of sex. And it's just like, oh yeah, so you're a massive fucking pest then, aren't you? So he's positioned in juxtaposition to that president. But then also, just the other ones around him. This is one thing that I think this film is trying to gaslight me on hard, and I don't know what was their reasoning behind this. It's a big point that Natalie says, well, I broke up with my boyfriend, and he wasn't very nice, actually. He said I had chunky thighs, and no one would fancy a girl with chunky thighs.
He said no one's going to fancy a girl with thighs the size of big tree trunks. Not a nice guy, actually.
And so this is positioned as a real point of like, well, he's a bad guy. The Prime Minister, David, clearly doesn't think that she's got chunky thighs, so he's a good guy. And then later on, we have, like, David's aide coming in, and he's like,
you know Natalie, who works here?
And his aide, who's a woman, who seems by all accounts just to be, like, a polite, competent aide up till this point in the film, just goes,
the chubby girl.
Ooh, would we call her chubby?
I think there's a pretty sizable ass there, yes, sir.
And I was just like, what? And then David looks awfully pained at this, like, Is she fat? I wouldn't say she's fat. And it's like, well, okay, well, in these moments, David appears to be the very kind, sane person by comparison, because everyone else just seems to not be able to resist commenting on Natalie's weight, which, by the way, is totally not apparent from the way Natalie looks in any of the scenes.
I was going to say, so, firstly, is it inappropriate to talk about that at all? You know, like, let alone in a work setting. But two, it doesn't even appear to be remotely true.
And then, so I was like, I thought I knew what the film, I was like, right, you fucking all over the place with the reasoning, but I know what your logic is. Like, you're softening David's character by comparison. But then it threw me a right curveball at the end. David comes into, like, knocks on Natalie's family home, where Natalie's mum and dad are, and all the kids. And then, what does he say?
They call her Plumpy, don't they?
Well, perhaps you should come on later, Plumpy. Natalie.
Yeah, I feel like I'm being gaslit now. Where, do you want me to think that she has chubby thighs?
Also, if you took out all of those references, the plot, it's not relevant to the plot. Like, they're just, it's almost like on the day they started filming it, the actress who plays Natalie did something to offend Richard Curtis. Okay, guess he's getting absolutely slandered in every single scene in the film.
Because it's like, what was the motivation? But I can understand the aide, who's like, might be mildly competitive with Natalie. I can understand the ex-boyfriend, because you're trying to cast him badly. But then you have like her dad, who there's nothing else to show that he's like a bad person. He's like, all right, Plumpy, all right, Fatty, we'll see you later on. It's like, What are you doing, Richard? Totally uncalled for. It has nothing to do with anything.
Do you know what as well? It's at the end in the airport scene where Natalie goes and runs up to the Prime Minister and straddles him. when she jumps on him, he says,
"God, you weigh a lot."
God, you weigh a lot. And then she, she just laughs and is like, "Ah ha ha ha! You're so funny. Shut up." Even the Prime Minister can't help himself but get a little dig in there.
So there's some characters I see in the film as point of view characters who I'd characterize as such because we very clearly see the world through their lens.
Like who? So
David is one of these. We get to see them in scenes where they're alone, then we get to see them in scenes with other people. And when they're in those scenes with other people, those other people's characterization happens through the perspective of the point of view character. So Natalie is a really important one here where I feel like we only really get to see Natalie through David's lens.
Yeah.
To the extent that when he fires her, through by all accounts, what is just her getting grossly sexually harassed by the president of the United States. When he fires
her... I can't believe she did that. Fire her.
When he fires her, which is... it's a horrible action against a staff member who's been assaulted.
Yeah.
The camera then zooms back in on David's face and we see little sad David like, "Oh, that felt terrible for me, having to fire her." From Natalie's character, we really get a 2D, very compressed picture of who she actually is as a person. We have no idea what happens to her between the firing and her sending the Christmas card.
Yeah.
Or indeed what happens, you know, through her meeting with David, how she feels about him, any of that stuff, because, you know, it's all through his perspective.
Basically, quite a lot of the women in the film only exist as a kind of fantasy version of what the man wants. A lot of the characters who are women are just like sexy people that you work with who want to have sex with you.
Yeah.
Even more of an example of this is Mia, you know, the assistant of the guy who runs the branding agency or the marketing agency.
She is a diabolical temptress and we'll get on to her. But she's insane.
Harry seems to be like the big boss in this office. And as I found out on my second viewing, Mia is his new secretary / assistant. So she's just started working there. And in their very first interaction, she is immediately flirting with him.
I'd just be hanging around the mistletoe, hoping to be kissed.
And so you've got a boss who's like at least 20 years older than the new secretary / assistant. And I think in reality, if there was any kind of like sexual tension between two people like that in an office, it would be because the older guy wanted to have sex with the young hot assistant / secretary. In this film, Harry begrudgingly goes along with the fact that Mia, who's just like, Mia must have sex with him. She wants to have sex with him and she will do absolutely anything to make that happen.
It's an art gallery full of dark corners for doing dark deeds.
It's like Mia is in a porn film in the lead up to the sex. She's a porn actress in the lead up to the sex at all times. She would have it right now, right here, and like she's waiting. And Harry is like, he's like in a completely different kind of film where it's about an old man in the countryside trying to go about his business and getting subtly bothered by things that he encounters on his day-to-day life on the farm. Yeah. And these two characters from two different films collide in this parallel universe, which is Love Actually.
Yeah.
And so she's, every single line of dialogue from her is like, "Well, the room will have dark corners, and I guess there'll be room for you to fuck me." If.
Yeah.
And then he's like, "Oh, God. Oh, well, isn't that just like every woman?"
So key to the plot line is that Harry is married to the Prime Minister's sister,
Karen, who, by the way, is not a Karen at all. She's one of the most amazing women I've seen depicted in cinema. Full stop. I fucking love her.
Yeah, she is. Yeah, she's a great character. There's this story that happens where, as part of Mia's seduction, after she's already told Harry that he can do whatever he wants to her multiple times, she tells him that he needs to buy her a Christmas present.
"I thought I made it clear last night. When it comes to me, you can have everything.
So, what do you need?"
It's almost like he's been set an annoying task by someone at work, but that he has no choice but to go along with it.
"Something along the stationery line? Are you short of staplers?"
"No,
His facial expression is like, oh, I can't really be bothered to do this thing.
He's so annoyed all the way through.
Something pretty.
Right.
It's like, do you not realise what's going on here, Harry? Do you know? He's like, oh, some sort of woman who's just asking me to buy her things, and I guess I've got to do it. And just none of it really makes sense. And this is what I think is the real tragedy of the plot between Karen and her husband Harry, of what we can assume to be very many years, is that he doesn't actually ever have an affair.
No.
Like, it just seems to be a series of like very misguided choices and a lot of misunderstanding on Harry's part. I mean, you have to assume that on some level he knows what is going on. But at no point does he show this in any of his actions.
Surely for you to throw away your marriage to do this, it's going to be something that you're really excited by. He doesn't seem at all excited.
So that scene where like Emma Thompson's character Karen, after the party where she sees them dancing, and she's like, well, Mia's very pretty. And he's like, what? I didn't even realise. And she's like, I'd be careful there. I think you do know she's pretty. Do you think in his head after that, he's like, oh, what's she talking about? My annoying assistant who gave me to get a Christmas present? He doesn't even know like what plot he's in.
Also, his wife, in that moment where she kind of warns him that she's seen it, very chill.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Lays down the law.
You know, I've seen this. It's inappropriate, but it's not too late to just stop doing that and we'll be fine. He completely disregards that. So he's told by Mia that he has to buy her a gift in order to fuck her. And he decides to buy the gift while he's out
shopping with his wife. It's like, Harry, do you not get any like time windows as the CEO of an ad agency where you can just walk out the office? Apparently not. In a moment of just super on the nose framing, when they get to the Christmas party where Mia has beforehand said that she will be there in a dark corner, and at that very moment opened up her legs, like, in a move that will be, I have no illusions, a complete mystery to Harry, what's going on? Why have you opened your legs while you're speaking to me? What's going on there? She turns up to the party with like a little Satan horns on her head, wearing a red dress, leaving the audience like there's no subtleness here. She is the devil.
Also, it's not a fancy dress party. It's a work Christmas party.
Oh God. Yeah. And it's just like, I mean, I forgive the film for it because I think it carries it off excellently. But there's just no subtlety involved, no emotions. And like you said, yes, a very close tie-in with Natalie in the fact that she's utterly unconvincing as a three-dimensional character.
Yeah, she only exists when someone is thinking about her.
There's you could make an assumption that perhaps she's going for power at the agency and she thinks she'll get it through seducing the CEO. But given that she's got a CEO who seems unbothered about that sort of thing, you wouldn't look at Harry and be like, oh, the way to climb up here is to, you know, fucking...
You gotta shag him.
If anything, it seems like the real way to Harry's heart is to divulge gossip about who you fancy in the office, which is what he seems genuinely interested in, right?
And how long have you been in love with Carl, our enigmatic chief designer?
So yeah, his first scene in the film is he brings Sarah into his office, who is the woman whose brother is in hospital, and he tells her that he knows she loves Carl, who's the head designer, and he absolutely loves getting into this gossip with her, does he?
And he goes up to her later again, completely like uncalled for, and he's like, let's talk about the you fancying Carl situation then, Sarah.
Any progress with our matchmaking plan?
It is funny. I feel like there are a lot of moments like that in the film where, obviously, because it's like an anthology, and part of the whole thing is that all the stories overlap and interweave with each other.
Yep.
But the world building for why they interweave with each other is just non-existent. They literally just put people in a room together and then almost decide afterwards what their relationship is with each other.
There's so many moments that I noticed. Like after seeing the film, you then go back and when you watch it a second time, you see, like, for example, Jamie, who is the one who ends up falling in love with the Portuguese maid, is sitting next to Sarah, the workaholic woman who fancies Carl. And they never have another scene together or any more dialogue. So we're just kind of led to, I guess people just assume they vaguely know each other because they all, it's all interwoven.
Yeah.
This leads us on to the character at the center. I think it's her subplot. If it's anyone's subplot, it's not really Harry's. It's Karen's subplot, isn't it? And there's just so many moments where I thought that is just incredible characterization, the way that Richard Curtis has laid it out. So one of these was code switching for mums. So she's talking to her brother. Is he called Daniel? The brother whose wife's died, right? They're having this conversation. You'd expect it to be very consoling. And she's like,
get a grip. People hate sissies. No one's ever going to shag you if you cry all the time.
So it kind of shows her as this really, like, you know, balls to the wall, transparently honest character. She says what's on her mind. She doesn't, like, beat around the bush with people. But there's another scene where she's with a family. And then she speaks in this really different way, but which is, I think, believable, which is...
Actually, do you mind if I just absent myself for a second? Darling, could you make sure the kids are ready to go?
So this is the moment where she realises that her husband has bought the necklace for another woman. So she's distraught to see this.
But the swearing's gone. That balls to the wall, emotions on display is gone. Suddenly when she's around the family, she has all those barriers locked in that you do as a mum. It's like, oh, think about the kids first. Think about the way I come across to them right now. And I thought that was just fantastic.
They basically have to leave Christmas Eve to go to the school Christmas show, Christmas panto, whatever, where the kids are performing as lobsters in the nativity play. And afterwards, she waits until after the show, and then she just casually brings up that she's noticed that her husband has bought an expensive necklace for another woman.
Tell me, if you were in my position, what would you do? Imagine your husband bought a gold necklace and come Christmas gave it to somebody else.
And she is kind of delivering this, like, this very crushing information very casually. And someone interrupts her while she's saying it.
Would you wait around to find out if it...
No, happy Christmas. Would you wait around to find out if it's...
And I thought the way that she kind of cuts off, says bye, and then returns to the crushing delivery of you cheating on me.
Sex and a necklace, or if worst of all, it's a necklace and love.
That scene specifically, because the argument takes place in public, the way that it unfolds is so different to what you would, to how that information would be shared in, say, like a really trashy traditional rom-com, where it's like, I don't know, they're outside and it's raining and no one can hear you and you're screaming that you're upset. But it's like, no, you're at the kids' school where you don't want to embarrass your kids and there's all, everyone's around. So you're delivering this information with half a ear to everything else that's going on. And it's that kind of like understated British delivery of...
I mean, Richard Curtis might write that argument in the rain scene, but there'd be some old man walking through the middle of them like, hey, can you two keep it down?
Yeah.
yeah, great. And like, so in contrast to that, we get, I think, I mean, for me, it's probably the best moment of the film where she opens that, well, she realizes that her husband has not got her this gold necklace. It's a Joni Mitchell CD. And she goes up to her bedroom. And I think that's when we get the true sort of reaction, and it cuts. It's one of those moments in the film, which it does quite a few times, where dialogue cut, it's music, and we get these, this set of still images. So music playing, and it is a Joni Mitchell tune as well. It's a picture of her kids. It's a picture of the husband. It's a picture of her and her husband. It's a picture of her. And I could almost imagine this as a kind of a comic storyboard illustrating those emotions that it shows. She was downstairs in the living room where it's really cluttered, really warm tonal colours on all the walls and this sort of buzzing, cluttered family life that she's in the middle of. And then suddenly she's in the bedroom. It's really muted colours. She's standing solitary on the side of the frame. It's just her on her own. And I think it gets across that feeling really well of, no, I'm on my own with this. I can't share this with any of my family.
That's a great point, Tim. That's a great point.
Yeah. And it's, so this is the other thing that I was about to say is, like, I think watching the Christmas films that I've watched, they fucking love a music bit.
Do you know what? It's the, for me, it's a really iconic moment where they have a full song in Love Actually. Is so it's the storyline where there's the guy, let me get his name.
Who's Mark, in, stalker guy.
Mark, who's in love with his best friend's wife. And it's the scene, it's like probably one of the most iconic scenes from the film where he recorded some film at their wedding. And she discovers, against his will, that all of the shots are just really weird, creepy close-up shots of her face. And her finding out is a devastating moment for his character. And it's like a Dido song that comes on. And then he walks out of his house and he does this weird little slut drop where he just like drops down and he's burst back up again full of emotion and just stomps through the estate.
So you can hear him like sort of over the music going, oh! And then there's this old man clearly being instructed, right, your role in this scene is you're going to walk past this guy. He's going to go, rah! And then you act surprised that he's like, you know, he's blocked your way. But he kind of, the old man's reaction is sort of behind. So he goes, oh! And the old man carries on walking for like a millisecond and goes, oh! And it's like, act surprised. There's a guy in my way. But yeah, so that same goes with that scene where, okay, we have music that's swelling. So the dialogue's gone, but it's not just a soundtrack being played for no reason. We're seeing the plot being moved on. So in that scene after the reveal with the Dido song, it's to show, okay, his anguish. We're seeing him walk down the street, him reacting to what's just happened. And our focus is with him as a character, what he's going through. There's the Karen reaction to the golden necklace, which is we're seeing a montage of the family. We're seeing the stages of her processing. My family, it's gone. I'm on my own. There's another scene where Sarah, workaholic, dances with Carl, her favorite guy. The music is high in that bit as well, but the camera is very tightly on her face. And we're seeing her slowly, like slowly this smile begin to form as she realizes, oh, it's happening. I'm with this guy. I think it's really easy for that stuff to go unnoticed, but that's what makes those song moments bearable in comparison to other films. It's something that has intent and purpose. It develops the plot, or it gives us characterization.
Another great point, Tim.
Oh, I'm full of them.
You're full of them. You're full of them.
Can you tell that I did A-level English? Yes. Yes. I was wasted on Of Mice and Men.
One of the plot lines that we haven't covered much yet, and which I do think there is there's some political analysis to be dug out.
I can't wait. Go on, Aidan, tell the class the political themes of this little rom-com subplot.
So, Jamie, who is the he's the author, who while he's at his friend's wedding, his wife shags his brother. He goes to France, and while he's in France, he gets a new housekeeper who doesn't speak any English or French because she's Portuguese. Her name is Aurelia.
This is Aurelia.
Je suis trésorier de vous avoir ici.
She's Portuguese.
By the end of the film, they're engaged to be married. I think the film, the timeline of the film was like 3 weeks, something like that, isn't it? So
it's ludicrous.
One, they get committed pretty fast. And two, they learn a foreign language.
Very fast.
In order to communicate with each other at the end. But I was trying to ask myself the question, in the post-Brexit Britain, would it be possible for them to fall in love?
Oh, well done. He's brought it back to politics. Yeah. Come on. That was good. You've got to admit, that was a good analysis.
Stuff like that. That's why I'm here, mate.
To be honest, I think of it through that lens of like her coming over to be with him through what you can assume is a green card marriage, although they are in love. Also, it's a little bit like sex tourism because he went over there, essentially found himself a younger woman. And then
who he's never had a meaningful conversation with.
And again, much like Hugh Grant, he gets away with it because Colin Farrell is charming, good looking, he's very witty. So we don't think of it in those terms. But there's a little element of like, ooh. Certainly in the bit where at the end he goes through the Portuguese, I guess, little hamlet or whatever it is.
So yeah, he decides that he's in love with her and he goes to the place where her family lives in Portugal and knocks on the door of her family home.
I mean, the way that every single person is portrayed in that Portuguese town, the real myriad of buffoonery from dad to the sister to the townsfolk, They're like the basic bitches in Beauty and the Beast who go to skewer the beast after hearing about him living on his like mountaintop. Like, oh, we're married. Oh.
You know, I find joke. So like when he knocks on the door and he says, I want to marry your daughter. They get confused about which daughter it is. But they're all the way through the conversation Portuguese. There's this running thing of, oh, dad is selling Aurelia as a slave to this British man. Almost like Borat level of like, talking about women, like,
it is
so
that
weird.
On the nose. It is that on the nose.
And yeah, also just the idea that people in Portugal are really parochial and someone getting married to someone that they don't know is fascinating. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, we must follow this group around town.
So a little thing I noticed, which if I was at like a film convention or something and Richard Curtis was there, I would nerdily put this question to him very pointedly. So the love, actually the film starts off with a thesis that actually I think you'll find that love is all around us. When the Twin Towers attack happened, it wasn't messages of vengeance or anger that people were sending. It was messages of love. Look around Heathrow Airport, you'll see love everywhere. And I think to myself, okay, so what about Jamie's brother who shagged his wife? Where was he at the loving end of the film? We didn't see him, did we?
He was showing, to be fair, he was showing a lot of love to Jamie's wife.
Didn't seem like he was included in the big love sesh at the end of the film. Seems like he was quite quickly discarded after he did a horrible thing. So I don't know about that. I don't know about that thesis. I think if there was any messages between Jamie and his brother at the end, they probably would be a vengeance and betrayal and how dare you.
Yeah, I can't imagine the brother's going to be invited to the wedding with Aurelia, if I'm honest.
I don't think so. I don't think so. He'd sleep with her too, wouldn't he? The wily devil. I think one really, really good part of the Jamie and Aurelia plot, I thought the use of the separate languages, the language barrier, was actually done really well. The particular bit in their house where they get to a point of understanding where she can gesticulate what genre she thinks his book is.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And he's like, crime. He's like, oh, yeah, it's crime. Blah, blah, blah. She's like, tenez miedo, blah, blah. And she's like, and he gets that she's saying, oh, is it scary? And he's like, yeah, pretty scary. Mostly scary how bad the writing is, which is an excellent witty joke, which any English guy would be proud of making. And it just goes over her head. And so you have this moment of like close proximity and they're connecting and it's all going in the right direction. And then suddenly the language wall. And the way that it builds you up to say, oh, it's not a problem, it's not a problem, it's not a problem. Oh, it is. I thought that was really, really well executed.
Yeah, it's good. I think the fact that their whole story together just makes him look like an idiot. I think that is the reason why you forgive the very strange circumstances by which they start this romantic relationship, where it's like, you're her boss. It's just the two of you there. She can't get home without you driving her home. You don't speak the same language as each other, but you kind of forgive it because when you're watching it, the power imbalance is sort of smoothed over by the fact that he's an idiot who she's constantly taking the piss out of.
Yes, and she's feisty that we see in those few moments where she cuts over his Portuguese with better English at the end.
Yeah.
And where she's dissing him all the way through their dialogue.
Yeah.
So transitioning from someone that we empathize and feel bad for, I think I want to talk about two characters who we have no empathy for and who are absolute scumbags, who the plot tries but fails to frame as somewhat lovable. And these two characters, which I think we should discuss together because I kind of bundle them up into the same sort of area, is Mark the Stalker and Colin Frissell, the Seedy Pervert.
Yes. I think both storylines would not be acceptable in a film made now. They're both like hangovers from that era of films like 40-Year-Old Virgin and things like that, where...
I would say 40-Year-Old Virgin is like vastly complimenting what these plots are. We're talking about Kevin and Perry Go Large, Harold and Kumar Get the Munchies, some of the scenes in American Pie, but without any of the cleverer writing. I mean, the Colin Frissell plot in particular, what is going on in that plot?
Yeah. So Colin Frissell, he basically decides that because no one in the UK wants to shag him, he needs to go to America to meet hot American women who will inevitably find his British accent irresistible.
I've just worked out why I can never find true love.
Why is that?
English girls. They're stuck up, you see. So I should just go to America.
Okay, these are ready to go.
I would get a girlfriend there instantly.
And here's the thing with that idea, the way it comes out. There's other points in the film where people have these brainwaves and change the course of their behavior or something they're going to do later on in the film. So there's little boy Sam, who wants to impress his high school crush, Joanna, sees Billy Mack performing the song on his TV, and he's like, oh, I should be a rock star. So you can kind of see how that ideas come to him. Hugh Grant receiving the card in his office, and he has the idea, oh, I need to do this heroic approach and go back and win Natalie back. So you can see, you know, it's not like these ideas are just ripped out of nowhere. You can kind of see where they come from. Colin is just delivering muffins and stuff. And then the scene where he goes to his mate and he's like, I am going to go to America. And it's like, okay, why? Where on earth has this come from? Where America suddenly would have like lower standards than everyone that you're speaking to in England who fucking hates you and you're terrible at flirting.
So the only setup that they really do in the film for him being unpopular with women is him at work as the muffin delivery guy, going around to different women in the office that he fancies and giving them free snacks. And also, it's not even like he has a rapport with them and he has a conversation. They're just ignoring him because he's just a weird guy who's just bringing snacks to them. In the film, it's not like they have a setup where it's like, oh, I really fancy this woman, but then she goes for someone else. And you don't see that development. It's just like, from the very start, he's presented as, in the UK, completely unfuckable and annoying. And in the US, mysteriously, completely irresistible.
As well, it doesn't interweave with any of the other plot lines. I don't know if it was some sort of executive decision made by the production company that, you know, this film, it's really girly. You know, we need a little something in there for the guys, something that the guys can watch and relate to. And it was a late addition, so they couldn't tie it into any of the plot lines, but it's just there. To me, if that is the case, it's all romantic plot lines going in. The guys, they're going to get put off by that. Or if they're there, they obviously have signed up for a nice girly rom-com. Colin, the way it's written, is terrible. He has no character arc. If we look at all the other characters, you know, it shows them going on a journey where they learn something. You know, Karen, Emma Thompson, it's my marriage isn't what it seemed. My life isn't what it seemed before. The Prime Minister, it's realizing that, you know, my social class shouldn't preclude me from getting involved with, you know, this woman and having this relationship I want to have. But Colin, it's like, I'm a seedy creep. And guess what? I should be a seedy creep just in America.
Yeah, I think it's this. The film, the story, rewards him for being...
that is what is insufferable.
Moron.
Yeah.
The moron that he is at the start is exactly the same moron that he is at the end. But he's rewarded for it by having a really hot American girlfriend who comes back to the UK with him.
If Richard Curtis went on a George... it's called George Lucas arc, editing scenes out, please chop Colin. Colin is not loved by the fan base. He's not loved by anyone. Just get rid of that whole plot goes right straight out the window. And Mark, I mean, so Mark, they really tried something here. They got out of it the memorable scene that is iconic now, isn't it? The card holding, you know, for Christmas, I just want to tell you that I love you the way you are. Blah, 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 blah.
Here's my problem with that whole scene, right? Despite, I mean, obviously it's weird and creepy. He's in love with his best friend's wife. And if he really has to communicate that to her, surely it would be better to do that in a way that does not risk your friendship with your best friend. Because the way he does it, he puts everything on the line for nothing. Because he's like, I'm not expecting or hoping for anything out of this. I just need to tell you because it's Christmas and we tell the truth at Christmas. But then he's at the door of his best friend trying to tell his best friend's wife that he loves her.
I also noticed another manipulative Love Actually film editing trick or film writing trick that they tried to pull on me, but it didn't work, where his friend Peter, who again... there's no sign of Peter being a bad guy at any point up till this stage. He seems to be a very normal dude. He's asking his best friend Mark to be kind to his wife, a fairly reasonable request. And then we get to this scene, and it's the part where Mark's about to show up at the door with his little cards. He rings the doorbell. She, like, Keira Knightley's character comes down the stairs. He starts playing carol music and shows a card saying, tell him it's carolers. And then Keira Knightley's like, it's carolers. And Peter's like,
well, give him a quid and tell him to bugger off.
Tell him they can bugger off. And I was like, okay, all right. Where's that come from? Jesus Christ. And I can only surmise that in order to take the heat off Mark for being a creepy, seedy fuck for the whole film, and arguably continuing to be a seedy fuck, but the film's about to frame him positively, they want us to have like, oh, Peter's a real bad guy. Oh, he kind of sucks. Peter kind of sucks. Oh, I guess he doesn't really deserve all of Keira Knightley's affection. And, you know, he kind of deserves to have his wife told that, you know, the friend fancies her. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, I mean, if I at the start of a film, like this is the opening scene, and I see a guy who is told from downstairs, oh, carolers are at the door, and he's like, tell him to bugger off. You know, I'd be thinking this is like a Scrooge type character. He really needs to undergo some, the film's going to be about his character development to become kinder.
Yeah.
Just like throwing Peter under the bus right at the end in order to give Mark a smoother exit from the film. So he does the cards, he does all that stuff, and then they've also, I love the part, so he does the cards, Keira Knightley kisses him, again, weird, like, doesn't need, he's just said all he wants is to tell you, she doesn't need you to kiss him.
And also, like, your husband is just over there, like, inside.
If he just decides to look out the window at the carolers, you're kissing his best mate. Which I guess is fine, because he hates carolers. He's a fucking Mardi Gras Scrooge. So Mark, the stalker, walking away from this, stops, meaningfully looks kind of almost into the camera and says,
enough. Enough now.
And I was like, oh, so you've tied up that little loose end, haven't you? Oh, yeah, so that's, he's not going to come back for more kisses? No? The stalker who, like, fancies her, the extent that he would, like, record her face close up for the whole of her, he wouldn't come back to try and kiss her again. It's like this really, like, unique kind of stalker that we've never seen before, where when he gets kissed intimately, he gives up.
He's like, oh, do you know what? That wasn't everything I was cracked up to be. I'm done with this.
I need a firm decision here from the jumping off points analyst desk. Does Mark wank to the video?
Hey, such a clear and obvious yes. Like, there's no doubt in my mind.
To me, it seems undeniable.
You got to think about the time period from like this. So 2003, people didn't really have camera phones. So having a video at all of personal memories wasn't as widespread as it is now.
And he's edited it.
He's edited it.
The
film is an
edit. It's like not like the full day. And here's like, it's an edit, and yeah, it's right there on his video top. She finds it straight away. She's like, oh, it's got a bit of slime on it, Mark. What's I thought, well, there's a video here that's entitled Peter and Juliet. I think we're on the right track. Oh, why is it all slimy? And I was like, she's taken it so well, considering.
Yeah, she doesn't seem bothered at all. If anything, it's weird, because especially, you know, with the scene where he's holding up all the cards and he's telling her he loves her, she enjoys it. She enjoys the attention, which is like not at all how a normal person would react. If someone comes to your door, they're telling you, your partner is like 10 feet away from you but can't see you, and they're telling you that you've got to keep this whole situation that's happening a secret from them. That would be hugely stressful if you decide to go along with it.
Goodness.
But she's like, oh, this is so cute, so romantic. On that topic, I watched there was a made-for-TV sequel of Love Actually called Red Nose Day, actually. It's about 15 minutes long and it's utter garbage, but it's basically a shot for shot remake of some of the most iconic scenes from the film.
Oh god.
But as if the characters have like moved on and everything. So they recreate, Mark comes to her door again with cards, and then at some point halfway through the conversation, his wife comes into the frame and she's also holding cards and answering questions with the cards.
What do her cards say?
So her cards, there's a whole bit about how no one likes Mark's new beard, and she has a card that says, I also don't like his beard.
That's good stuff. That's good. I mean, that is, you let in humbly, but that was a pretty good sketch.
Pretty good bit, yeah.
Kind of stuff I'd write.
So I think my last piece of attempting to find some political analysis to dive into was in the story of Billy Mack and Joe.
Yes.
So Billy Mack is an aging rock star who has re-recorded a classic song to make it into a Christmas song, basically. And his love story is with his manager, Joe, who he spends the whole film insulting before and after he confesses his undying platonic love for Joe. Yeah, Joe is just the butt of all the jokes, basically.
And without knowing it, I've gone and spent most of my adult life with a chubby employee. It might be that the people I love is, in fact, you.
I mean, I would say I've reflected on this, and I think this is one that I think does come across very differently now. In 2003, when Love Actually was filmed, I think Gary Glitter was known as a paedophilic guy. Nothing had come out at this point about Jimmy Savile or Rolf Harris. There is a disposition to this old aging rock star, and it's there in a lot of scenes in the way he interacts with BBC show presenters, being very, very awkwardly, jarringly inappropriate with them.
That's true.
And especially then in the scene with Michael Parkinson, where he's like, all right, I don't want me to give you a little sneak peek. And he like gets his knob out on TV and like pushes it in Michael Parkinson's face. It works for the film. There's nothing that I would say is detrimental about it. It didn't ruin the film. But there's overtones of that kind of character and those sort of mannerisms on TV of putting other presenters in a space where they don't feel safe, but they're just, you know, they kind of have to go along with you because you're some old, aged icon.
Yeah, it's true. It's very like Russell Brand.
It drew a lot of parallels with Russell Brand, Jimmy Savile, all these people that we know use that overt disposition.
Hiding in plain sight. You're telling us exactly what you're doing all the time, but because you're doing it so theatrically and entertainingly, it's seen as funny and entertaining rather than troubling.
Yeah, I'm such a zany sexual freak that I do as an act, that when I start being that with you, you still think it's an act up until the point where we cross some invisible boundary that you haven't realized we stepped over right at the beginning because I've been a sexual freak from the start. And I think that is, yeah, I just, watching a lot of those scenes, the way he acts, I can't help but feel, not that it drew out those things, but that he was somewhat based on a similar kind of character to Jimmy Savile.
True, that would now be, I think people would be more skeptical about that kind of character in real life if a new person came onto the scene was being very inappropriate in interviews. I think it would be tolerated less than it was at the time of the film was made.
Yeah, and obviously we as the audience know that Bill Nye is not a sexual deviant that we know of.
Yeah,
and he's not a paedophile, but someone in that position, they kind of, it's kind of hinted at that everyone, you know, On his day when he gets number one, he's like, you know, you're gonna find me asleep with like 20 different women, blah 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 blah.
Yeah,
it's kind of hinted at someone in that position. It did draw out something for me watching his plotline now in 2023 that it wouldn't have done back then.
There's so much troubling sexist relationship stuff in the film that that's almost kind of the baseline, isn't it? Where any analysis of that is you're commenting on something that is ever present in the film. Basically,
it's like there's like been a hurricane of sexual deviance in this film, and I'm sweeping up the little dust at the side that is Bill Nye's character. Like, oh, yeah, he's a bit sus what he's doing. It's like we've got a guy who's fucking stalked his wife, he's stalked his best friend's wife.
Yeah, the point that I was going to make was that I wanted to know what you think about what the film's message is about recreating old pieces of art for money.
There's clearly a message that, and so obviously 2003, this was a time where all of those shows, Pop Idol, American Idol, as it went on to be, I can't remember the names of a lot of them, Who Wants to Be a Pop Star, those shows had just, to my recollection, they just picked up steam. And there is an explicit reference to this through Bill Nye's dialogue that says, oh, shouldn't it be me instead of some young, pretty young thing who's just been gifted it by the, you know, so it's an overt reference, I think, there to the Pop Idol, American Idol culture of them always getting the Christmas number one. Yeah, in terms of what the film has to say along those lines about recreation of art for commercial reasons, it's definitely not a critique of any of that.
I completely agree.
It could be justified for someone who's seen as suitably deserving because of them being past their prime, because there's nothing going for them. So it's like a charity case.
Yeah. The story of Billy Mack is, at the start of the film, he's kind of past it, is a bit of a nobody. No one really cares about him. He re-records a classic song as a Christmas song, and against all odds, he manages to beat a band of the Now into having the Christmas number one. And at the start, the film and the character himself takes the piss out of how ridiculous and pathetic it is that he's doing this. The film also wants you to want him to win, right? Yes. Like it doesn't want you to laugh at him all the way through and at the end be like, lol, you're pathetic and you lost. It wants you to think he can do it.
That's it, yeah. He also serves very well as this narrative tying together device, because it's very clear to me that all the points where they couldn't think of a tie-in for the stories, they just cut to a TV and his song's on the TV. I don't know if you picked that up. Just like whenever they didn't have like a good segue, they just cut to like some performance of him on the TV. Yeah, it seems to me like he, in the context of the film, is an underdog. Now, whether that's warranted by who he actually is, even from what we know, seems probably not, right? I mean, it seems like he's a pretty hedonistic pop star who is selfish and has only thought about himself for his whole life. So if anything, it's more a reflection on, you know, the fact that he says he's going to get his cock out on Christmas Day, not to bring back the Jimmy Savile references at all. It's more ties into this British tradition of, you know, self-denigrating, like let's make fun of ourselves a bit, and that's what he's being celebrated for rather than the actual achievement of the number one, right?
Yeah. So I also think that the story of an old rock star re-recording a classic song to become a Christmas hit, like you say, it's told in the film as if it's an underdog story, but really that's quite a typical thing.
Very common.
The last five Christmas number ones in the UK have all been made by a YouTuber called Lad Baby.
Oh, I fucking hate
dude, those. He's so annoying. But so they are, I mean, to be fair, they're for charity, so whatever. But they are like just the most cash grab songs ever. Like they're like, oh, we'll feature Elton John in a song about sausage rolls. You know, like it's even more ridiculous than what happens in the film.
Painfully unfunny. Like, yeah. Just painfully. It just seems to me, as you say, like people have been past their prime recording a Christmas song. How many times do you meet someone who is into, you know, the Beatles, and you're like, oh, what's the best Paul McCartney song do you reckon then that he's written? And they're like, oh, it's Simply Having a Wonderful Christmas Time. Have you ever heard that? I've never heard. I never will hear that. These are bottom of the barrel tunes which get a pass because it's Christmas.
Also, the artists that have the easiest time of making money in the music industry now are people who make music that's listened to by older people.
Yeah.
Because they're the people who spend money on music, and the artists who sell the most copies of records are older artists.
So I was watching the regional news for my local area, right? And they had someone called Donny Osmond, who had just done the lights in a little local place, in a little local town.
Oh, turning on the Christmas lights in a local village.
And he was on the regional news, and they were like, why are you here, Donny? Which I was like, yes, why are you here?
Great question.
And he was like, I just love this little place in England. I love it. And by the way, I've got a Christmas show coming up in Nottingham, and I'd love to see people. So it's like, oh, so it's like a little plug for your show,
right?
And I was like, going, I logged on to see, like, it was really curious, like what the ticket sales like. He's fucking sold out every night, and he's not been popular in like 40 years, and he's selling out like arenas. This is just insane. It's perplexing.
I think it's partly because before the internet, music tastes were much more centralized around what was on the radio, right? So you've got whole generations of people who all grew up listening to the same artists. And now that they're older people with money, those artists are the people that they go and see still. Our generation is like, you know, even you and me, who have a very compatible music taste, probably only listen to like 10% of the same stuff.
It's making me laugh. It's like, oh yeah, those old people just listen to revisiting music from their childhood. It's like, it cut to our conversation. It's like, oh yeah, Machine Drums EP from 10 years ago. So sick. Really set the standard for what people are doing now. Missing those first EP. Oh my God. We will never experience anything like that again.
If Missing No re-recorded a classic hit as a Christmas song, I would go wild for that. I would love it.
All right, well, this has been lovely, Aidan. I've really enjoyed dissecting what is a classic, a staple of my Christmas regime with you.
It's one of those films that it's great to watch it because you're having fun watching it, but also it's great to take the piss out of it because there are so many parts that are just so dumb.
It's so good. And I think I'm going to enjoy listening to this one back. We've pulled out so much and I've actually forgotten, amongst the myriad of points about Mark the Stalker and Colin Frissell, everything we said before that. Thanks very much, everyone, for listening. The podcast will resume in the new year.
Yes,
it will. Maybe we'll have some fucking politics to talk about.
Yeah, let's hope. Thanks for listening, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.
Jumping off of... Jumping off of...